Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the webinar, Using Drones to Generate Farm Insights, the Drone Basics and Operations. The webinar is being presented by John Coulombe. John runs his own drone training and consultancy company, and he's been active in horticulture for over 8 years, if I'm not mistaken, John. Please type in your questions during the webinar by clicking on the Q&A button that's on the bottom of your screen. And don't wait until the end, because after the presentation, John will answer your questions and we will definitely have some time for them. Also, please use the mute button. That's the little microphone icon on the lower left on your screen, just to avoid background noise and feedback. Importantly, this webinar is being recorded, and we will send a link to the recording to everyone who was registered. So don't worry about any recordings afterwards. We will send it to you. And the content for this webinar comes from the Hort Innovation Project Fiji 1678. That's the Soil Wealth and Integrated Crop Protection Phase 2. It's led by AHR and RMCG. And the project is funded by the Vegetable Levy with funds from the Australian government and managed by Hort Innovation. For now, John, the floor is yours.
All right, thank you very much. Let me just share my screen and get going. So, good day, everybody. Just as Peter said, this is going to cover some of the basics, and then I'll go into some of the simple uses or simple ways to use the drones on the farm, just as a kind of a bonus. But the main thing is there's a lot of confusion out there about the legalities and liabilities of farmers or anybody for that matter using drones. And there's been some major changes at CASA. They're the kind of the RTA of the Sky Safety Association. So without further ado, I'll get into it. So the goal of this webinar is basically to kind of help you guys understand a bit more about what the liabilities are and the legal stuff also, and just in case you aren't aware. And hopefully to show you how easy it is to use these drones, and then also to show you how to process the data and then answer any questions. So I'm obviously not from Australia originally. I've been here about 18 years, but I was doing a PhD in Bundaberg using drones for looking at water moisture changes in crops, tree crops and small crops. So yeah, learned quite a bit about what the drone can and can't do. I'm a trainer by profession, do a lot of school training and resource management training using drones. I'll just quickly go. So I've got a certified CASA training company, and also I do a lot of advanced training for organizations that want to get a bit of a head start on using their drones. Did a degree at Southern Cross, was great living in Byron Bay at the time, got a graduate certificate in lieu of the PhD. Had a couple of kids during the PhD, so went on to business. I've been an adjunct at UQ for quite a long time, just from some of my soil biology days, and yeah, lecture whenever I can. And just so clearly, I'm not employed by CASA, and these are my interpretations. And some of the stuff is straight off of the CASA website. So going forward. So in the CASA training that I do, the first things you go over is what are the responsibilities of a drone pilot. A lot of people don't realize that there's quite a few rules for all drone users, not just for people using drones for business. You'll find that you're gonna know, maybe after this webinar, you're gonna realize that, probably 80% of the people you see with drones are breaking a law of some level, whether they're taking off within 30 meters of you or, anyway, I'll go over some of those real quickly. So I always like to point out that the drone pilot is, at the end of the day, you're driving it or flying it. So it's just like a car. You can't say, well, my boss told me to drive this fast. You're the one holding the controller. And if you flew into something, the lawyers are going to want to talk to you first and then to the owner of the farm and then to the trainer that might have trained you. But anyway, it's a pretty serious deal when you have a, because these are aircraft, so you know it's not a vehicle, a tractor, or anything like that. It's entered the airspace, and CASA takes it very seriously. So this is what this webinar is about, just to kind of give you some you know, knowledge and confidence that you're doing the right thing. You're not going to get fined. So you might not need a special license. Most of you probably won't. But in the past, you were able to fly on your farms without anything because it was your own property. CASA's changed that since July, and that's what I'm going to talk about real quick. Even if you don't need a license, they lawyers and you know, liability wise, it's still, I always recommend, you know, having some sort of, just like you would with your sprayer or hazmat stuff, you know, you want to keep some sort of documentation just in case it flies into a picker or something happens. You've done some risk assessment. So this is CASA's kind of sheet. These are the things that doesn't matter if you're flying for recreation or on your farm. You can only fly one at a time. You can't just turn it on and walk away. You've got to be able to operate it. You can fly autonomously or automated, I should say, fully automated, but not autonomous. You can't just let it fly itself. It'll fly waypoints without you controlling it, but you have to be in control if something goes wrong. It's got to keep below 400 feet. It can only fly during the daytime. This is without a license. This is just for everybody with a drone over 500 grams, I think, or over 200 grams now. Visibility needs to be good, clear of clouds, keep the drone in sight, stay clear of populous areas, stay at least 30 meters from people. You can't fly over people. Don't create a hazard, you know, flying into a footy match or something like that, or flying over areas you don't need to. You're not allowed to fly over emergency situations like crashes or fires and stuff like that. And you got to operate within the drone's capabilities, which is, you know, you've got a manual that says this drone's rated up to 40 kilometers of wind. If you crash and it's 50 kilometers of wind and the lawyer can prove it, you could get into some trouble. So these are things just trying to protect you guys, I guess. So this is the best image I've found where, because it's always very, people think, oh, I'm 30 meters away from somebody, but you still can't fly over them. So this, I hope this kind of, it's been hard in the past to kind of explain this to people. So the green marks mean that's where you can fly, and the red one, no. So, and I know you see it at the beach every day. You see it, you know, everywhere. It happens to me all the time, you know, but on your farm, you know, if you don't want to, you know, there happens to be somebody filming you or whatever, you know, just be aware of it. And visual line of sight, that means you got to be able to see the drone. So if it goes behind a tree, or if you're flying, you know, tree crops and you're flying low, you might have to stand up on the ute so you can see the drone at all times. Pardon me. All right, so getting into what you can and can't do and what you need to fly. So the license is usually anywhere from $1,500 to $2,500, the remote pilot license. This is stuff that I do as a job. And it's a 5 to 6 day pretty intensive course. And then with that, you're able to fly at night. You have to still put in a request and make sure that you have the right documentation. And you can fly within 5 kilometers of a manned airport. You can, you know, fly above 400 feet. But without a license, you can't do any of that. But to fly on your farm, you don't need this license. So you're because it's your own land, and you know, you're not charging the people for your drone services. It might just be an agronomist on your farm, the manager, you, your kid, whatever. You don't need a license. The thing that I said it's considered the landowner or private landholder excluded category. And these are examples. So you guys, obviously farmers, are part of that. The thing that's changed is in the past you didn't need to do anything, but now you have to get an aviation reference number. It's free. You just log on to CASA, you have your passport. It's quite straightforward. It's an aviation reference number. And then you have to get accreditation now. And this is for everybody that's not flying for recreation. So if you're flying to check the dam height on your farm, that's not recreation. And so you need to register your drone. So yeah, register your drone. That was January 28th was the date, but for anybody that hasn't, you know, you're not going to be fined or anything. You just still, I'm just telling you, you got to register your drone. And then they just started, I think it's as of maybe in July, it's going to be $40 for, it was free when they started it. And then they've just announced it's going to be $40 per drone to register it. That's the full cost. And it's a, the accreditation, I think I talk about it. It's a 3-year, it doesn't cost anything to watch the video and do a few questions on the CASA site. So that makes you, and then you got to fly within those conditions. You can't fly more than one drone. You can't fly within 30 meters. You still have to do all those things. Even with a remote pilot license from CASA, you still have to operate within those conditions, and you can apply to operate outside of them if you, but you still can't fly within 30 meters of people unless you've put in a request or a risk assessment, and then keep some records. So that's new. Also, they want people that are, so if you're, you know, in the past, if you were a real estate salesman, you wanted to take some photos of your place and put it on the web, you didn't need a license. You didn't need to register your drone. There was nothing because you were, it was under 2 kilograms. But now that's the big, that's the main change that I wanted to kind of get out there. So basically this is just a thing that they've got on the CASA website. You know, have you got an ARN? If you do, then go to step 3. If you completed the accreditation, you got the registered your RPA. It's all through the My CASA portal. Pretty straightforward, just like MyGov. You know, they're pretty straightforward. But they want you to be able to prove that. So if a police or a CASA, I don't know, police person or whatever, catches you flying your drone on your farm, and it's obviously you're not doing it for recreation, they can fine you. I think it's up to 11 grand. I don't know what that's going to look like, but that's the potential. And I just put this up there because I didn't know until recently you had to be 16 years or older to get that accreditation, or you need a parent, a guardian there while you're flying. So yeah, just be aware of that. So you don't need the accreditation if you've got the remote pilot license, or if you're just going to be flying for fun. And so, yeah, it's, well, the accreditation is free and online, and it's valid for 3 years and required. And these are some of the costs for the penalties. So that was it as far as the what I wanted to get across to, as far as what is needed for flying a drone and for anything other than recreational. So now I'll get into the kind of some of the things that you might want to use your drone for on your farm and how to do it. With the limited time, I mean, I do a 2 or 3 day course on how to use these drones to get the most out of them. But so I'll really kind of quickly go over some of the lingo, because it's always a bit, you know, people, RGB, it just means a camera, you know, your phone camera, but this one's strapped to a drone. So most of what I do is RGB. During my PhD was with the multispectral, where it sees outside of our vision, you know, in the near infrared. Those are where you get the NDVI index and NDRE and some of the other algorithms that work on the near infrared spectrums. And then the vary is just these algorithms or indexes are just equations, you know, like red minus blue over blue plus green divided, whatever. It's not that complicated. And they've been around, the NDVI has been around for 40 years. So it's not all of a sudden just happened. This vary is the one that applies to the RGB. So the imaging that I'm going to show you, when you see the heat map, the pretty picture, some people call it, the yellows and the reds are just from the visual spectrum, from the red, green, and blue. The orthomosaic map is what's the most common thing generated from these drones when they fly the grids. It's a scaled map that's very, very accurate depending on your height, but usually within a few centimeters, you can measure distances from trees, you know, spacing, crop spacing, volumetrics, elevations, all kinds of stuff. I won't go into the point cloud stuff that much, or big data. So as you guys know, you've probably been watching Landline and been to some workshop in the last few years about drones. I know I've done a few on weeds and whatnot, on mapping invasive weeds and being able to not only locate them, but also to measure them. And, you know, just the volume you've got 4 acres and you can measure the different sets of weeds, then you can know how much product you're going to need and know where to go to spray, plant counts, all these things, you know, are, and most of these things, except for before they're visible, that's the near infrared, but most of these things you're seeing are all with probably your kid's Mavic, you know, like an off the shelf drone from JB Hi-Fi, Harvey Norman. So they're not, we're not talking rocket science, you know, these are, I still use the Phantom 4. I just bought another one, you know, a month or two ago, because they're as good as you need. They got a 20 megapixel, 1-inch mechanical shutter camera, and they've got all the sensing on it. So it's, yeah, for about $2,300, you can have a really, really good drone and getting really good aerial imaging. So just real quickly, I always go through this. So you're flying is, you know, my 5-year-old can fly a little drone from Kmart. So the flying is really the least important. It's when you process it, and then where the real money comes from is analyzing the data and understanding where your variation in your crop is. Even the height differences in crops can be really helpful. And irrigation leaks, as I said, where the weeds are coming from, just gives you a really different perspective of your crop too. You don't have to use all these algorithms. You know, you can just put the drone up and have a look at the ends of your drip lines to see if one blew out. You don't have to walk down every row and see, you know, every time you, maybe even the first couple of times you charge your irrigation up, you just fly the section and see if there's any rats a bit or whatever, grasshoppers or whatever chew through your drip lines and stuff. So it can just be quite, well, it is, not can be, it is very, very useful just from a different perspective of your crop, being able to see it from the air. I just was gonna show you, so there's several flight planning software. Flying the flights in the grid pattern, it's a free app. Usually, you know, you just, it's quite simple. I'm gonna go through one right now. When you process it is when you get into the cost. So I use Drone Deploy over the last three or four years. You have, anywhere you are, it comes up on your iPad. It gives you a start kind of in the area they think you wanna do it. Then you just start stretching it around the block that you wanna fly. Gives you these lines. At the end of each one of these lines is a waypoint. As long as you know, almost everywhere in the world, you've got at least 9 satellites. It'll go up to, you hit the button, it'll go up to 60 meters, fly to the first waypoint and just fly it and take photos and take the 86 photos up to 3 hectares and then land and turn off. And then you take the SD card out. And then that's the value. That's where you then put it in your computer, upload it. I always remind people if they are doing these automated flights, they can still do a live assessment. As it's flying the grid, it's looking straight down. As long as you're still looking at your drone, you can't just, because it's got to have that visual line of sight to be legal, but you can actually be seeing the crop health and, you know, if a pig's been through or if there's somebody left some trash or whatever, you know, if there's a leak. A lot of people just with this automated stuff, they'll just have it go up and then they'll just wait for their data, then get back. And they could have seen a leak while it was gathering the data and taking care of it before they left the farm. So you fly it, you go, it goes up, it does a thing, lands. And then you come back, you just say new upload. You choose the name, you select the photos from a folder, you say upload, and that's it. You've basically done an automated mission flight with photogrammetry. You know, you've uploaded it to the program. You're gonna get a map back in a few days to be able to annotate and do your assessment. I'm sorry. Probably a half hour from the company I work with, not a few days, that's going back a few years. And that's what it looks like. So this one's not the best example, but that's an orthomosaic map. Now that's a scaled high resolution map that I can zoom into and measure. I can also apply, this is the RGB algorithm that shows you the green areas. Oops, you know, it's just taking those pixels and giving them numbers. And then once it's got enough of them, it creates this map. And then you can zoom in and have a bit of a look at your crop a bit closer, and then compare it to the algorithm to start seeing trends. You know, you can start seeing a dead patch, looks like a red spot. So you might pull back and be able to see that in a bigger scale and see that you've got a lot of missing plants or, you know, dead spots or something like that. It's just really good to be able to, and this is how you do it. So I'm actually ground truthing it from the visual imagery, and you can even go in quite far and see if there's a footprint or a pair of sunglasses or whatever. So it's quite high resolution just with that Phantom, with that little 20 megapixel camera. And all these are geo-referenced. So, you know, here's a dead spot. I can just draw a quick little polygon around it, quite simple. Tells me the area. So if I want to go get seed for that area, I know that I need enough seed to cover 26 meters squared, well, whatever, a number of things you can do. If I want to measure the width between the treatment, it tells me it's been cultivated, there's lots of little dips. You know, if there's tire tracks or elevation change, it'll tell me that. The length and the degree of fall. Then there's accounting. I won't go through the whole program, but there's a lot of tools in this program. This costs about $6,000 a year to use this program and to upload all your photos and whatnot. But as you can see, it comes in pretty handy. You can, you know, do the full area of the treatment and then, you know, divide it by the different. So you can see some variation in, you know, that's probably weeds there and stuff. Then you can really start to see it in this algorithm. And then you zoom in and yeah, you identify it as a variation in the crop. You know, whether it's, I'm just using that, it's not actually a weed, but it could be. And then you, again, draw your polygons, draw it around that section. You might have six of those and then you add them up and you find out you got 800 meters square of, you know, weeds or grubs or whatever it might be, you know, out of your 4 hectares. And then you decide whether it's worth going in and spraying or transplanting or whatever. Just it's up to you what you do with the information. This is what it looks like without the algorithm. And sometimes, you know, in cattle farming and stuff, it's quite dry. But then you put the algorithm on and it still is going to pick up the different light reflections that the camera picks up and give it, you know, a color or a number and then group it. I always like to mention in these presentations that it's not a silver bullet. It doesn't do everything. It's just one tool that you can use to help you manage the crop. It's getting there with a lot of PhD research, and you know, a lot of people say it can do all these things, but it really can't tell you what the variation is. It can just tell you that right there's a difference in the green of that crop. And then generally you might be able to see it by zooming in on the visual part and say, oh, that's aphids, or oh, that's Xanthomonas, you know, it's bacterial spot, without even going out there. But you may have to go out there but you may not, you know, it might be six rows in and 100 meters down the row and you don't even know it's there. And if you see it from above, then you can go hit it with a hand spray or whatever and stop the spread of the disease. They're doing that a lot with, like in vineyards, looking for Boisus farius, you know, where they can pick out the limbs where it's affected and go and cut them or take the whole plant out. Because if you can get, well, you guys know more than me, but if you can get it early and stop it from spreading, and even with an insect, you know, pressure, you can find out, see where it's coming from, if it's coming from the neighbor's crop or if they've oversprayed or just anything. It just gives you a very different perspective of your crop to make decisions on. So I've been doing a lot of weed workshops and, you know, using sprayers, and these sprayers also have a granule dispenser where you can actually drop grass seeds or granules of chemical slow release, you know, even slow release fertilizer in certain areas that are need help that you can't get to, or it's too muddy to get into. So that's one way of using it. For you go out there with the smaller drone, you find them, you map it, and then you come back, you draw little polygons around it like I just showed you, and then you feed that information into the spray drone and it just goes straight out to the section that needs to be sprayed, the valve, the weeds or whatever. Real quickly, I've been messing around with some of this machine learning, and you know, this Swiss company is getting pretty good at being able to you have to put a little bit of work into it. You've got to go in and do this little edge detection stuff on, but you might find that you want to count all your plants that are over a certain size. So you use the drone, you get the imagery, you use this program, and then you start circling the plants that you want to count. And then the next time you fly it, it won't count the smaller plants. It'll just count the ones that fit that, what you've taught it. So it's just another level of, and tell you where you're missing a plant, you know, or where all your plants are under a certain size. They use it for counting cows and horses or utes versus cars. Yeah, there's still a bit in it. I also wanted to kind of go over the some emphasis on that. Like I said, it's part of your management tools. So it's meant to go in with your EM information, yield data. So, you know, you got all these different bits of information, you know, your set flow graphs and things like that. And it just helps you identify areas that have a variation and kind of link it up with some of your soil types and, you know, historical knowledge of your farm, and then start making decisions on whether you, you know, want to focus on that section. We're using it for, you know, nutrient, you know, what do you call it? Localized or specific delivery of nutrients and pesticides and stuff. So when it's a little bit more technical, but you got to have the RTK drone and map it, and then you can feed that into your tractor, and then it'll only put down the fertilizer where at the rate that you programmed in. So you with that drone imagery, you can put it into zones and then feed that in, but it's getting a bit more complicated in that level. The other thing I try to emphasize is that a lot of people in this business tend to simplify it and make it seem like the NIR is real simple, and the infrared, or, you know, I can't think of the word for that, putting the nutrients where you want it, but and even the weed stuff, you know, where the weed seekers that used to be mounted on the tractors, and you know, it works, but there's a bit more money in it, a bit more complication. So when I was doing the PhD, that was one of the reasons I started doing the training, because I wanted to educate farmers that there's a pretty simple way to use the drones on their farm to really help them manage their farm. So, and I reckon I've done a few little ag tech things and stuff, and I think drones should be in every farmer's ute, you know, because they're not that expensive. And when you go out to turn the valve on, you throw it up, it does a mission that you've already programmed for block 6, you know, planting 7, and it flies it. And yeah, you may not watch it the whole time and do a live assessment, but you've captured data from that day of your crop. And when you get back and you're having your coffee, you plug it in, you bring it up, and you're like, oh man, I didn't know, you know, 6 rows in and 4 trees down, there was a dead limb, or there was, you know, a leaf flush, or I've got premature nut drop. All these things that you can't see sometimes from the ground, or maybe your sprayer didn't pick it up when he was out there. Who knows? I'm still surprised in my, you know, this far into it with the cost of the drones, that it's just not being used as much as I would think it should be. But anyway, so these are just some of the applications. Sorry, I just skipped through that. But, you know, if you're doing trials on your farm and you want to, as we all do, you want to try some biological stuff, or you want to try different fungicides, it's a real good way to, you know, several farms will have companies doing efficacy tests and trying different methodologies and to improve your farming and yields and all that. And it's, maybe they're giving you graphs and things like that. But if you've got the drone, you can fly it. It's quite easy to annotate and to look at what treatments and where, and then make your own decision along with the scientific data. But that was one of the reasons I actually wanted to get into drones, because I was doing all this, you know, beneficial microbial products and testing all over Australia, really. And, you know, you can do up all the graphs, but visually it's hard to relate to that. And so having this overhead perspective of it and being able to see the crop and to see the treatments was, I thought was really helpful. And I think, yeah, and also this was a pretty good example for insurance purposes. You know, if you've got a hail or, you know, a wind damage lodging, you can fly it and measure those more accurately than the insurance company might do on the ground. They might just look at it and say, oh, it's not that bad. So you can, it's one of the things I like about the drones is that you're capturing a space and time also. So if anything does happen or if you do get a disease, you know, and you start getting into, once you realize how simple they are and you just start using it because it's just a battery and you throw it up on your blocks that you know are going to have issues. And like I said, you can have a whole management plan. You can say, okay, we're going to fly a block before planting. We're going to fly it 3 weeks after transplant to check for mortality rates and, you know, irrigation profiles. You can see the soil moisture profile is different color when the soil gets wet. You could probably see where a blocked or, you know, a blockage of your drip line is. Maybe see where one's been chewed through because it's quite obviously the soil's a bit wetter in the inter row. It's just endless, you know, from just a simple little flight, you capture, you know, an overhead view of your property. So anyway, I don't know if I've sold you on drones or, you know, given you enough thinking about it, but I think that's pretty much, is that right, Peter? Is that?
Beautiful.
About a half hour, all right.
Thanks a lot, John. We do have a few questions. The first one is, so I'm a vegetable farmer and I want to use my drone for business. Can you clarify what I need to do to be legal? You kind of explained it in the introduction, but just very, very straightforward. What steps should I be taking?
All right. Well, two things. So if you're a vegetable farmer and that's your business and you're going to use drones to help you in your business or help other people, you're not a drone consultant. So there's two things CASA kind of designates. So I'm assuming, as you say, you're a vegetable farmer. So the only thing you need to do is register it. Like I said, you get an ARN, an aviation reference number, which is, you go online with CASA, and they've got a drone section, you know, it's quite direct.
What is CASA?
That's the Aviation Safety Authority.
Okay.
For all of Australia, for the any airspace. I didn't mention, but I think it was in my slides, but I forgot to mention that you may want to get aviation insurance. That's what I did when I realized that my liability insurance didn't cover me once my aircraft left the ground. So when you get into the national airspace, which is anything above the ground, your $20 million liability that you got on the farm is out the window because you're not driving a tractor. You're not, you know, so if that drone runs into a picker or into a Mercedes or whatever, you're pretty much out there. So I pay about $800 a year for $10 million of aviation insurance, just in case my little Phantom 4 drops. Never has. Well, I have crashed, but I haven't damaged anything. But so yeah, just get an ARN, register it, and that's pretty much it.
And the liability insurance cost, is that high or?
Well, that's what the $800 is what.
Okay, so that's the same aviation and liability.
Well, it is
insurance.
It's not aviation. It's aviation liability insurance.
Okay.
Sorry, it's not. So you can have whole insurance. So but I don't worry too much about the $2,000 drone. I just want to make sure, just like when I'm driving, if I hit somebody, they're not going to own my house. You know, so that's what I get. I get it's called aviation insurance because it's for the aviation industry. So it's the one I use is through QBE, which is Australian Aviation Insurance, I think they're called. And then you just get a quote and as long as you're not spraying, that's a bit more expensive if you're doing a spray drone because of the chemicals and all that. But if you're just flying a Maverick or a Phantom 4, then you don't have to have it. I mean, literally on your own farm, I would, you know, I didn't have it for 2 or 3 years because I was flying big properties, you know, and the only thing that was going to damage was my own ute. So, but all right.
Okay. Thanks. And is it legal to fly over the field of a neighbor?
Yes. So you're allowed, nobody owns the airspace. And again, this is my interpretation. So, but I've been studying this for quite a while. I get asked it quite a bit, you know. Even privacy laws are, you know, been tested in courts all around the world. And it'd have to be a pretty big breach, you know, of privacy to be considered. It's usually the fault of the person that knocks the drone down that's over their backyard, gets in trouble, not the drone pilot. So, it's not flying neighborly, as they call it in the aviation industry. You know, so you'd want to let your neighbor know, or you know, when I fly over houses, you know, I might do a mailbox drop and let them know that, you know, at this time I'm going to be flying Jim's roof to do a solar panel inspection, and I'll be over your roof. And sometimes you have to, I've even had to do, when I do council stuff, I have to go building to building and say, look, we're going to be flying, please don't come out. Because if they happen to come out when I'm flying over the top of them, that can be considered a breach of the regulation. So if a tractor is driving on your farm and you fly over the top of them, you know, I'm just telling you, that's, you're not supposed to be doing that. So.
Okay. And if I would like to buy a drone, what are the main things? What's the most important I need to buy? What would you recommend?
My biggest recommendation is, and it depends on what you want to do, but for what I've been talking about and what I've been doing for quite a while, you know, a Mavic, even a Mavic 2 Air with a 12 megapixel camera is quite good. You get really good, pretty good resolution. With the 20 megapixel camera at 60 or 70 meters, you'll get probably 3 or 4 centimeters, maybe 5 or 6, I guess, resolution in your measurements and stuff. So the lower you fly with the higher megapixels, the higher resolution you get. But yeah, the Mavic 2 Pro is a 20 megapixel camera, and the Phantom 4 Pro is a 20 megapixel camera. So yeah, either of those I think are the two best. That's what I generally use.
And like if I would like to use it for weed control in, let's say, leafy vegetables, what resolution would you recommend? Is that 20?
Yeah.
So, is that right?
Yeah. So I mean, all the weed workshops I've done, you know, for GrowCalm and different organizations, that's, as you can see in that, in those photos, I mean, you should be able to determine a weed, especially during flowering, or certain stages of the weed will be greener than your tomatoes or different, well, in leafy crops, it should be a different, and you should be able to see it on the algorithm. But even if you can't see it on that, you'd be able to see it visually. And then you can, with the program, you can then zoom in and out, you know, draw a polygon around it and measure the actual amount of infestation. And then, you know, for your management purposes, you can then decide whether it's worth loading up the sprayer or just sending somebody out with a quad to hit it, you know, just so it doesn't spread. You start to get trends too with this. If you do it over time, from crop to crop, season to season, you know, even different planting varieties and things like that, you'll start to see where your weed pressure is quite a bit more clearly from the aerial stuff. And I've noticed that you can also, you know, after you've done your prep and all that, you'll start to see where the weeds are coming in your cultivated land, and maybe understand, obviously, where it's probably going to be heaviest when the plants start coming in, once you lay the plastic and things like that. So the aerial stuff, definitely, just with the, you know, like I said, the $2,000 drone, I talk about that as not much. Sometimes that's a lot of money to certain people, but if it saves you a few thousand dollars every week or month because you're not using as much chemical, or you found something, quite often you might detect something that you wouldn't have picked up, whether it's an irrigation leak or bugs or whatever. So in my opinion, it, you know, it's just the same as, you know, people say, oh, you know, like getting a computer is a big deal, but now you can't live without them. I think that's where the drone's headed.
Okay, and if you would go one step further with that weed control story, and you would like to use your drone for chemical spraying or biological spraying, is there any legal difference between spraying by a drone compared to spraying by ground equipment?
Yeah. So there's aerial spraying, you know, just as if you were in a helicopter spraying. So there's a whole nother certification process you go through with the chemical, you know, training organizations. But not only that, it's a they're up in the 30 to 50 kilogram weight classification. The spray drones are quite massive, and they require to use them properly, they require a special drone to map. So you need an RTK drone. So the RT, you can get a Phantom 4 RTK with the ground station. It's about 13 grand. The spray drone, I just got a quote actually recently with the spray drone and everything you need, it's about $53,000 for the drones and the batteries and, you know, all the whatever. Then the training on top of that, you have to get training up to 25 kg, which I can do as a training organization. But then you have to go to CASA to get your next certification, which is 25 to 150 or something like that. And then you got to get the chemical certification and then insurance. You know, if you overspray or, you know, the drone flies away with glyphosate and keeps spraying, you know, there's a whole nother level. But, you know, look, that's when you start getting into some really big savings, but big implications too, and a bit more to it.
Okay, going back to the remote sensing thing, is Google Earth, is it easy to implement when you want to use your drone to create images? Is that okay?
Well, you can't create images in Google Earth, but you can take the processed orthomosaic or GeoTIFF and drop it into Google Earth Pro, and it'll fly it to wherever that was done and place it there on Google Earth and overlay it. And then you can't quite zoom in as much as you can with the other products. I could show you the program, but the program, you actually have to use and pay for a program to upload your images to get them processed into these maps. And then they usually give the annotation tools, the elevation tools, you know, the volumetrics area tools and all that, and the counting parts of it. They're very, very good. Some of them are, like I said, $6,000 a year for the business plan. I think it's $3,000 for the starter part of the processing, but you don't get as much, but it still can be useful. You just have to weigh out what you want to you know, the value. If it's going to save you $10,000 a month to fly the drone and use this $6,000 a year software, it's pretty straightforward. You only have to pick up one problem to get it paid back. But if you just want to use the kid's Mavic, or you've got a drone, you got a Phantom, you go for Christmas or whatever, you don't have to process the data. You don't have to fly the waypoints. You can fly it and take photos 30, 40, 50 meters up. And then, you know, you get them back on your computer, on your high definition TV or just your computer screen, and you zoom in and you're going to be able to see, you know, a break in the drip line, or you're going to be able to see a broken branch, or any kind of visual detection. So without any kind of software, I mean, not any kind, just with a drone with an SD card in it, you're going to get a lot of value out of just that data. I just go to the, you know, I've been using the program and find a lot more use, because I was just doing a thing in Emerald. They had some flooding and their access road to their farm, well, one of their blocks, it was quite a large farm, got the creek had overflowed, and it was just all ditches going through it, and the water had settled on their block. And I was able to fly it with some students, actually, some high school students, and give them a really detailed map of how much volume they would need to fill each breach of the road to get it back to being usable. And that was really useful. And actually, they were going to use it to show the other farmers. And there was some a bit more to it because they some other farms had built up to keep the water from coming on their farm, which redirected it. So she can use it to show that the damage to her road and that block was caused by, you know, the water being redirected. So even if you, one thing I'm learning and on that project, it doesn't even have to do with crops. It can just be with infrastructure and looking at your roads and looking at your dams and figuring out, you know, elevations. And I know you, the end stuff is quite useful, but fence lines, just any number of things, you know.
Okay, beautiful. I think we covered all the questions. So thank you very much, John, for the presentation and the discussion. Thanks to all for attending to today's webinar on using drones to generate farm insights. That was Drone Basics and Operations. This webinar has been recorded, as I told you, and we will send a link to the recording to everyone who has registered. We will also include a link to other resources on drone use and vegetable farming, and hopefully together with the presentation of this webinar. For any other resources to be found on the project, please go to the website soilwealth.com.au, and the Hort Innovation Project VG16078, that's the Soil Wealth and Integrated Crop Protection Phase 2, is funded by the Vegetable Levy with funds from the Australian government and managed by Hort Innovation. Thanks for your time. It's been a pleasure, and enjoy the rest of your day. See you later.